If you're a Canadian conservative, you are probably feeling massively underwhelmed when looking at this CPC leadership race, but have no fear. I am here to not disabuse you of any of your misgivings and instead just provide some, I think, thoughtful analysis on how each individual candidate can win this race, what their path to victory looks like. I'll go in sort of mainstream media current order. That would be McKay, O'Toole, Leslyn Lewis, Derek Sloan, sort of the order they set out for us at the beginning. Now, according to internal party polling, it is very, very close, and each candidate does have a shot of winning, which is why I wanted to do this video and just sort of give you a breakdown analysis of how each candidate could go. I do love this audience, but if we could avoid a repeat of the CPC Andrew Scheer versus Maxime Bernier, when I said what each of them needed to do as an analytical point, and everyone, well, 10% of each side freaking out, can we do that here? So, without further ado, let us start with Peter McKay, whose path to victory relies heavily on apathy. Peter McKay is relying on the fact that it is the year 2006. He has the only name. So, unfortunately, this is how politics work. We like to pretend that, oh, Americans, it's a celebrity. Okay, before Americans elected Donald Trump, we elected Justin Trudeau, a drama teacher, because he was a name, right? Barack Obama became a name. Donald Trump is a name. People tend to go for a popular name they recognize. People, the way humans work, they just like something they are more familiar with, right? We tend to grow out of this, but if you have a 6-year-old child, right? I remember when my cousin wanted to watch Shrek every day at the cottage. It's just what happens. This is sort of the Peter McKay effect. Peter McKay is counting on the fact that everyone knows Peter McKay. I don't need to show up to any debates. I don't need to do anything else. I just need to go to all these mainstream media outlets and say, I'm Peter McKay, and I'm gonna Peter McKay. Now, the funny thing is, Peter McKay is actually a bit of a bluer Tory than he's letting on. He's just pretending to be more of a red Tory than he actually is, opposed to Erin O'Toole, who's a redder Tory than Peter McKay on his record, but he's pretending to be a blue Tory because the Conservative Party is spinning in circles. Now, so Peter McKay's pathway to victory really relies on I'm Peter McKay. Most people, when they get their ballots, will just look and say, who the hell's this? Who the hell's this? Who the hell's this? Oh yeah, Peter McKay. I remember him from the Harper years. That is his pathway to victory. That's the Peter McKay plan. How good of a plan is it? I don't know. I actually thought he should have, come up with policies, been at the debates, said some things that were actually interesting, made a few principled stands, made some noise, he would have won outright. But instead, we go to Erin O'Toole, whose pathway to victory sort of relies on sort of heavy leadership, social media promotion from he is connected with Ontario Proud and the Post Millennial. So his communications director Jeff Ballingall is owner of the Post Millennial and Ontario Proud. So he relies heavily on sort of these those Facebook videos you all see. They are produced by sort of Erin O'Toole's. We could just call them Peter O'Toole and Erin McKay for all I care. It's the same thing. So his strategy relies heavily on this sort of push to social media, get into that Peter McKay thing, right? Because Peter McKay's sort of marketing himself as a red Tory, and Erin O'Toole, who is a red Tory, is going to market himself as a blue Tory, hoping sort of to capitalize on that and also be sort of a friendly mainstream outlet. So I mean, he is sort of racking up sort of the internal party sort of recommendations, endorsements. Not all of them have, you hear some rumors by how not nicely he got those endorsements. But anyway, his pathway to victory really relies on being presented as a blue Tory. And I don't usually like to inject myself into politics, but it actually does kind of heavily rely on people not knowing that his campaign is suing me for $2.5 million for exposing his sort of, we'll say, neglect on extremism. And why is Mr. Blue Tory, Erin O'Toole, so happy to always, always, always be with Muslim Brotherhood front groups, right? Mr. I'm such a blue Tory and I take this all seriously. And I believe Erin O'Toole did say that Sharia law was 180 degrees away from Canadian values. Why does he not act like that? Well, that's the $2.5 million question. So his pathway to victory actually does kind of rely on shutting me up real good. And I kind of done the math on all the lawyers they hired, and they're pretty expensive and their fees and like all the stuff I've gotten. It's probably easily over $400,000, maybe $500,000 I spent in the last few months trying to ruin my life. So his pathway to victory relies on being presented as a blue Tory, which can also obviously be undermined if everyone finds out that everything I've ever said about him is true. Now, Brings us to Leslyn Lewis, who has the most vanilla, ironically, pathway towards victory, which is not be crazy, and it's the silver medal pathway to gold, is what I like to call Leslyn Lewis's pathway to victory. Now, she has very strong support within the Christian community, which is good because I like them. So you'll see her do well, and I think she's polling very well in Saskatchewan right now. You know, Alberta's in favor of her. So her strategy is essentially to, you know, win over some first place votes in the Christian community, you know, really plant her faith. And from what I hear, Leslyn Lewis is legitimately a believing Christian and does follow her values. So I'm not calling her out on like, she's just pandering to the Christians. No, she actually is one of you guys, if from what I hear. But what she's doing is her, listen, I'm not a crazy person strategy is, in the debate, she hasn't won any debates, but she hasn't looked like a crazy person. Whenever Leslyn Lewis talks, you go, okay, yeah, she's smart. She's not insane. Okay, she can win. And her strategy to victory seems to be to get as many second place votes as she can. Now, she might be trying to get first place votes, but her real pathway is second place votes and relies on Derek Sloan going out first. Maybe it's a ranked ballot. So let's say you vote Sloan number one, Lewis number two, which is a lot of anti-establishment people will do. If Derek Sloan doesn't get the requisite votes and he's eliminated in the first round, then all those Sloan one vote, Lewis votes two, all that Sloan support then goes to Lewis in the second round and should vaulter over McKay or O'Toole. If Leslyn Lewis doesn't come in fourth, I think there's a very, 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 very small chance she comes in third by this. I think by being everyone's sort of second choice and being ranked sort of two to three a lot more than the other ones, not being left off ballots, not being number four, she's kind of everyone's second choice. When a ranked ballot system after elimination rounds, this could get her to victory. Now, Derek Sloan's is the most interesting. So Derek Sloan, who is, you know, the fourth place candidate, his pathway to victory and sort of is... it's a really crazy plan. It's called being a conservative in the Conservative Party. Now, I know you're thinking, whoa, a Conservative Party in the Conservative Party? Whoa, this, we don't do this. This is Canada, right? This is the land of Justin Trudeau and Peter McKay and Aaron O'Toole. But Derek Sloan's plan is to actually be conservative, take stands on Bill C-16, mandatory masks, calling the Muslim Brotherhood an extremist organization, all these things that the Conservative Party actually believes. Everything the Conservative Party actually says it stands for, he's publicly standing for. I know, it's insane. It's absolutely insane. We can't even explain why anyone would be that crazy as to say very mainstream conservative things that actually the majority of Canadians believe in and then not apologize to the media for saying them. Crazy. Crazy, crazy, crazy. But his actual plan here is each riding has a certain amount of votes. So if I'm in a very heavily populated downtown Toronto riding, my vote is nowhere near as powerful as the votes in Nunavut, because each riding's worth 100 points, which means if there's like less than 100 registered Conservative Party voters in Nunavut, like each one of those votes is like a point, right? Whereas mine is like 0.001% of a maybe, you know? So his plan is he's concentrating really, really hard in the ridings that have ironically less conservatives than the other ridings do. So, I mean, going heavily in Quebec. Yeah, I saw something like, you know, the Google searches in Quebec, he's like 59% of the Google searches of each party, if you break of each candidate, 59% of the people searching a candidate in Quebec is Derek Sloan right now. So his pathway to victory is be conservative in the Conservative Party. I know, insane. Who would have thought of that? If any of the other candidates did this, they'd be winning outright. But only Sloan had the crazy idea to actually stand on conservative principles. Instead of Aaron O'Toole's like, I'm a true blue Tory. Are you with me in the fight for free speech and against cancel culture? Sure we are, Aaron O'Toole. Sure we are. Now, Sloan here, what he needs to do is he needs to beat Leslyn Lewis round one. This is, I mean, if you really believe in this way social media is trending, then the first one of Lewis or Sloan to go out, the second one to stay in has a very good chance of winning because it's very likely that most Lewis voters are putting Sloan 2 and most Sloan voters are putting Lewis 3. And it's also Lewis, I mean, Sloan's problem is because he is saying conservative things, the red Tories will freak out and, oh, I can't vote for someone who once said that we shouldn't be listening to Chinese propaganda to run the country. Oh, right? You get that sort of elitist stuff. So Derek Sloan is being left off a few ballots, whereas Leslyn Lewis isn't. So this is where, you know, Leslyn Lewis might actually have a better shot than Derek Sloan, but Derek Sloan really needs to win these rural ridings, these less populated ridings, and then needs to have Leslyn Lewis go out and then get her second space support to vault him to victory. And there you have it. Each candidate's pathway to victory. Please misinterpret every the last 10 minutes of what I just said and send me angry messages saying why I hate the candidate you currently support. I would really appreciate that.